For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. You may see your brother attacking you, people gossiping, people fighting, and then say these people are wicked. No, the people are enslaved to a prince of wickedness. And if you want to fight the people, you will waste your destiny, because they are slaves. They can't do otherwise. So what you do is to rise higher. It's to go higher than the influence of that spirit. When you pierce through the dark cloud, suddenly the wicked people, the same way they are slaves to that spirit, they'll become slaves to you. That's how we rule. We don't rule by fighting men. We rule by fighting spirits. So when Daniel pierced the canopy of Babylon, they said the king thought to make him king, president over the realm. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Principalities capture territories. Powers enslave men that are in that territory. The rulers of darkness provide laws that enslave their perpetual slavery, and wickedness in heavenly places afflicts them with the character of those spirits. It's a four-way operation. The word principality is ancient English, prince without a territory. So when he comes to a territory, he goes to the people that have authority there, and he begins to bargain with them. I will make you rich if you do this. So what they do is, when they enter a territory, they raise their own people. So they begin to look for the prophets, because the gift actually is from God. The devil can't give any good gift. So when they come and they discover in this territory there is somebody who can see into the spirit realm, they now reveal themselves to the person and they begin to bargain with the person, because the person has the gift from God to see into the spirit realm. So principalities come to survey the land and they find out the gifted ones. So when they find them, they bargain with them and they make them witches, wizards, sorcerers, warlocks, and sages. And they enter into covenants with them, and those men become the mouthpiece of the people, because the people have the right over the territory. So the mouthpiece negotiates with the people and they submit their will to the spirit in return for something, and the principality have secured that territory. The moment it does, it now brings the power. So the power now introduces fear. The power introduces sickness. The power introduces intimidation. The power introduces lust. So even when the people say we don't want anymore, they can't. Because the principality have taken the legal right over that jurisdiction. So he now brings his brother the power and he provides rulership over them. And in order to secure them beyond the people that make the covenant, he brings the rulers of darkness. Because if we make covenant, by the time all of us die, our children will come. By what means will they continue with the covenant? That's what the rulers come to do. They provide laws. So they now say, at the end of every month, go and do this, go and do this. So those laws create patterns. Those patterns now implicate generations unborn. And then spiritual wickedness is the one that brings the nature of the spirit. So the nature of the spirit may be death, it may be sickness, it may be wickedness, it may be pain. And he afflicts it, because every spirit wants to give expression to his nature. That is ministry, but in darkness. So you see these people, they say they are wicked. It's called ministry. They are giving expression to the nature of a spirit. These people, they are sick. It's called ministry. They are giving expression to the nature of a spirit. On that wise, he now sends apostles, prophets, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saint, first to declare rebellion against the spirit and to give them the wisdom that is required to walk against the protocol that the spirit has put in motion, so they will walk in liberty. And suddenly a generation of accursed people become a blessed generation, because he sent men that taught them the ways of God. That was what happened to Israel in Egypt. They were in captivity for 430 years until a prophet came. And the first thing he did was to fight the gods of Egypt. In Exodus chapter 12, verse 4, verse 12, it said, tonight I will pass through Egypt and I will judge the gods of Egypt. The moment the gods of Egypt were judged, Pharaoh let them go. And while they left, Moses now began to teach them laws, ordinances, status, precepts, because if they don't come back into God and learn the ways of God, even though they have left Egypt, they will carry Egypt in their heart. And if they carry Egypt in their heart, they will still be giving expression to the gods of Egypt. So they will not be the servants of God. But what God wants is to what? To raise a royal priesthood. God's own special people, giving expression to the excellencies of God. So Moses needed to teach them. And they didn't. So the generation that left Egypt, none of them entered the promised land. Because if they enter the promised land, they will still be servants of the gods of Egypt. Only Joshua and Caleb made it.